Hi, my name is Rami Ismail. I'm one half of a Dutch independent studio known as Vlambeer, and today I want to tell you about 17 useful lessons I learned while running a completely unorganized and chaotic game studio for almost for already five years that might or might not be useful to you. Vlambeer's two people, Rami Ismail and Jan Willem Nijman. This is me. I do the business and I do the development at Vlambeer. And I drink a lot of Coca-Cola. That is basically my job. It means I program and I negotiate and I do the marketing and stuff like that. This is the other guy. This is Jan Willem Nijman. Jan Willem is the designer at Vlambeer and he mostly draws doodles in books and then makes games out of those. We've made quite a few games. We're best known for games like Super Great Box, Radical Fishing, Lift Trousers, Gun Gods, Ridiculous Fishing, Nuclear Throne, all kind of stuff like that. And it all started about just over 5 years ago now, when me and JW were both university students at a university in the Netherlands, where we were studying game development. And me and JW really did not like each other. We were not friends. But the one thing we liked less than each other was our university. So we both dropped out and we decided to start a company together. Because that's a very reasonable thing to do. And we had this prototype. And this prototype back then was called Crates from Hell. Which was a very terrible looking, kind of way too hard, terrible sounding prototype of a game. But we knew there was something cool there, we just didn't quite know what. So, you know, if you're dropping out of school, the best reason to have is to go work with one of the people you really don't like with a shitty prototype that really isn't all that good. Don't do that. Really bad idea. So, obviously, we dropped out, and that was an instant success. We ate this for about 6 months of our lives. They're instant noodles. You could buy them in packs of three, as you can see, and then you'd get a 1 euro discount. So they'd be 2 euros instead of 3 euros. And they would come in three flavors, chicken and beef and duck. And the chicken and beef tasted terrible, but the duck was quite okay. But there were three in a pack and two of us, so we would have to fight over who got the third one. It was a great time. Anyway, we didn't have money, and we needed money, so we decided to do the one thing we were good at, which is make a game. So, we made a game about fishing with machine guns, bazookas, and assault rifles. Because... reasons. That game was Radical Fishing, and we sold it for $10,001. If you want to know about the $1, ask me later. And we used that $10,001 to turn Crates from Hell into Super Crate Box. And Super Crate Box was our first hit. It was a freeware game, so you made zero money. But we'd been eating noodles, and suddenly we were getting flown to San Francisco for the Independent Games Festival Award. And they gave us really fancy food, which was really cool. But it turns out that fancy food very often is very little food, so we'd get like very small portions, and that made us sad, but it was better than noodles. But people noticed us, you know, people started noticing us, and one day a guy we knew came to us and said, I want you to make a video game. And we said, okay. So we made a first-person shooter about gangster rap on Venus, because reasons. You will find that because reasons is a very common thing at Vlambeer. And this game went up really well, and then people started asking us to speak at events. We were like, why would you ask us to talk? We have no idea what we're doing. But people kept asking us, so we kept doing it. Then another company came to us and asked us to make a Serious Sam game. So we made a Serious Sam game that is a turn-based RPG. Then we started going to events, and this is the first time I ever had a Vlambeer t-shirt, so that's super exciting. I had a shirt with my own logo, that was cool. This was the Penny Arcade Expo, the first one we did, and I noticed that any good booth at event has a lot of merchandise, so I just started calling merchandise companies until one of them gave us merchandise for free in exchange for all the profit. So they basically, they earned some money on printing us a few t-shirts, and then our booth looked like we were a serious game studio, so that was cool. Then we started working on our next game, Ridiculous Fishing, which was an iOS version of that very first game we made, Radical Fishing. And we worked on that with a really cool team. We got like 5 people together from all over the world. And then the game got cloned. Somebody else stole our idea, and they made $1 million+ in a few weeks. And we were not very happy. We were very sad, actually. We kind of stopped working on games for about a year. And my job turned into giving interviews about that time somebody stole $1 million from us. Which, by the way, that story is fun to tell for about 3 times. And then you go like, do you really want me to tell about that time somebody stole $1 million from us? And it's like, yeah, tell me again. It's very upsetting. This was the New York Times, though. So if somebody is asking you to tell your story again, the New York Times, okay. That was cool. We decided to try again. So we finished, we worked on Ridiculous Fishing while we also worked on a new game, Luftrausers. Released Luftrausers, that did really, really well. Then released Ridiculous Fishing, and that became Game of the Year on Apple, so that was even cooler. And then Vlambeer was doing really well, all of a sudden. And at that point we decided to start a new project called Nuclear Throne, and that's the project we are still working on right now. So that's kind of what Vlambeer is, for those of you who needed an introduction. I promised 17 lessons, so we're going to do at least 17 lessons. So, there are a lot of things you can ask yourself while you're working on a game. You can ask yourself what the game is, and who the game is for, what the game is supposed to do, but I think the biggest question you can ask yourself is always going to be why. And why is a really odd question. Did they leave the door open? No? Okay, cool. I was like, come on. Why would you leave the door open, right? But why is an important question? Like, why do you make games? Have you ever thought about that? A lot of people think about that and they think they have an answer, but it's a really bad answer. Because people often stop at the first time. So if you ask yourself why do you make games? Well, games are cool. So why are games cool? That's a harder question, right? And you know that old game where you keep asking yourself why until the other person gets annoyed with you? So play that game with yourself. And you're going to get annoyed with yourself, but it's actually a very valuable thing. Why is at the core of pretty much everything we do? Why is at the core of design? Why is at the core of marketing? And obviously the reason a lot of us are in video games is because we love video games. Because otherwise this is a really bad profession to be in. Like, it's shitty pay, it's terrible hours, it's a lot of crunch. Nobody understands what you do. If you try to explain it to your family, they ask you to fix their computer for some reason. But why is a question you need to teach yourself? And it's a question that needs to be behind every decision. If you design a UI, think about why it looks that way. If you design your gameplay, why that gameplay? If you think about the art direction of your game, why that art style? Vlambeer games very often have pixel art. Can you guess why? Our games are about precision, right? They're about accuracy, they're about skill. The most honest way to display how a computer thinks, a binary machine, is pixels. A pixel either overlaps another pixel or it's next to it. So if you want to dodge a bullet in a Vlambeer game, you can see whether you're dodging the bullet because it's pixel art. If it was a softer style, if it was 3D, it would be much harder to see. But Vlambeer games are about that precision, so our art style reflects that. There's a why. So whenever you think about things, think about the why. Lesson 2. Design is communication. And communication is really, really hard. I'm sitting here talking to you, but I can assure you that like about 30% of my words don't really come across the exact way I intend to. There's a really fun exercise that I used to do where I ask an audience basically a really simple thing. So if I think of a word, I want you to think of the first word that comes to mind. Okay? So I'm gonna give a word, and then I'm gonna point at somebody, and I'm gonna ask them to respond with a word that is close to that word, that is the first word you think of. Okay? So for fun, let's start with you. We're gonna go with the word water.
Light blue.
Light blue? What do you think of? Somebody that
ocean.
Ocean? Clouds? Somebody else?
Wet?
Somebody else?
Just
sorry?
Drink.
So here's a word that we all agree about. Water. Right? And everybody in the audience that I kind of pointed at had a different answer. That's how bad words are at communicating ideas. They're really, really bad. And it gets worse, right? So I did at school, at university, I teach class as well sometimes. And I do a seminar where I ask students to make me a platformer. And I give them 20 minutes to ask me any question they want, any question at all. And then 4 days later, they have to give me a prototype of the platformer I have in mind. And if it's close to what I want, they pass. But if it's not, they fail. It's that simple. So they ask me, you know, what does it look like? And I say, oh, you know, it's like a normal platform. They're like, what do you do? Well, you get to the flag at the end of the level. Okay, so what can you do? I'm like, you can walk and you can jump. How does it control? Well, arrow keys, jump button, that's it. How do you defeat enemies? Are there enemies? Yes, there's enemies. How do you defeat them? You jump on top of them. Then I ask them to make a game. What game do you have in mind right now?
Super Mario
Bros. Everybody always gives me a 2D platformer. I mean a 3D platformer. They all fail. Literally nobody has ever done that exercise in a way that works, because nobody has ever made a 3D platformer. Because when I say platformer and I answer the questions the way I do, you think Super Mario. But I don't mean Super Mario, I'm just answering the questions in that way. You can have a conversation with somebody where you both 100% agree, but you don't mean the same thing. So if you're communicating about games, communicate in our medium. If you're trying to communicate art, draw it. If you're trying to communicate sound, make the sound. When I talk to my sound designer, I don't say, I want it to sound like a shotgun, or like, I want it to sound like a splat. I just go like, yeah, it's kind of that sound. I kind of want that, but like with a bit more bass. And that works, because now they have an idea. If you're talking about game design, make a prototype. The simplest thing, just use squares. Okay? So talk in the medium that you're trying to talk about, because words, terrible. So lesson three is be a little less normal. Or what I'm really trying to say is normal doesn't exist. I am not normal. You're all not normal. Normal does not exist. Normal is a social construct that we have to make life easier to understand. And the truth is, the good thing is, if nobody is normal, then everybody is interesting. Right? Because everybody's weird. Everybody has their own little quirks, their own interests that make them different than anybody else. And what you need to do is to stop trying to pretend, stop pretending to be normal. You're you. You're special. There's nobody like you. Just be you. But you have to allow other people to get to know you. If you're going to make a game, you're going to put part of yourself in that. And if you're just trying to be normal, if you're just trying to fit in, you're going to make a really boring game. You have to make the game that is you. You have to make a thing that reflects you, because you are weird, just like me. And that's what makes our work interesting. So, lesson four is you have to give more than you take. And that's kind of weird, because in economics, you're doing well when you take more than you give. Right? If you take more stuff than you're giving out, then you're doing well. Now, in life, it's kind of the opposite. If you're taking more than you give, you're an asshole. That's how it works. So, when you get to the point in life where you have the ability to give back more than you take, that's the moment you're successful. Not a moment earlier, not a moment later. If you can give back more to your community, to your friends, to your colleagues, to your employees, than you take out of them, that's when you're doing good. So make that your goal. If you're not there yet, Make that your goal. Make it your goal to always give back more than you take. If you're a game development studio that's doing pretty well, start organizing community evenings. Start organizing community events. Start writing blog posts about the things that went well, the things that went poorly. Start reaching out to other developers, but make sure that you're always giving more than you take. And that's what will make you successful if you're not successful, because people appreciate when you give. People notice that. So give. So honesty helps you make better games. The thing is, honesty from other people also helps you make better games. There are four types of feedback you can give when somebody shows you their game. Okay? The first one is, the game is good, and you give them feedback that it is good. This is great. Okay? The second one is, the game is bad, and you tell them that it's bad. That's also great. The third one is, the game is good, but you tell them that it's bad. Now you're an asshole, but it doesn't hurt. The worst thing that's going to happen is the things you tell them that are bad, they can fix. And the fourth one is, the game is bad, but you tell them it's good. Now you're actively hurting them. That is actually hurting them. Because here is a bad game, a game that could be better if only you give honest feedback. And instead somebody slams the door. No, and instead you tell them that it's good. And they go home happy, thinking that their game is good, and they're going to release a bad game. Never, ever do that. If a game is bad, tell them it's bad. Sure, it might hurt. Sure, they're your friends. Sure, they're other developers. Sure, you want to be positive. Burn down the entire game. Just destroy it. Be as critical as possible. Be a jerk. Find one thing that you like. Just one thing in the game. Destroy the entire game and then end with that one positive thing if you want to make them feel good. You're like, the gameplay is terrible, I don't like it, the controls are bad, but that one tree there looks really good. Good enough. But be that honest. Please be that honest. So there's a skill in games that's really important, and the skill is to be able to talk about your game. Do you all know what pitching is? It's the idea of being able to communicate what your game is in about three sentences. Who here is working on a game right now? Like a game that they want to sell? Okay, so, surprise, let's do a pitching round. There was a microphone here, but I don't know where it went. Who has the microphone? Where did the microphone go? Somebody stole the microphone? Good. Who here was making a video game? Nobody? All of a sudden? All right, can you give the microphone to somebody raising their hand? Hey, if you could please get up. You can do it in whatever language you prefer. What language are you going to use?
Spanish.
Okay, wait, let me see if this works. Can English? Can English speak? I don't... Hello? I don't hear anything. All right, just go. Just go for it. Sorry.
One minute.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
It's a 3D platform.
All right. Let's give me one second. Because then I can hear it, and that would be great. I speak about this much Spanish, which I'm very impressed that all of you can listen to me, because I can't understand any Spanish, like a little bit. I was listening to a talk before that Daniel was giving, and literally all I could understand was that at some point he said, Jonathan Blow. And I'm like, I know that. Sorry for the wait, by the way. All right, let's go. Yeah, I can hear you.
Mi juego es un plataforma 3D, donde el protagonista genera sonido y está relacionado la frecuencia del sonido que genera con la frecuencia del color de las cosas del nivel, entonces afecta solamente a las cosas del color que generó el jugador.
Wait, that's three sentences. That's more than three sentences. All right, good. Thank you. So I really like the idea of this game, right? And I'm going to look for it tonight. What name do I enter in Google? Do you know? No? Didn't mention name. Okay. What was the game like? How did it look?
Colors?
What? 3D platformer. It's a 3D platformer? Yeah, okay. 3D platformer, that's cool. What does it look like? No? Something with sound, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the sound did something with things. I don't know what things are. I have a hard time imagining this game. Luckily I know what platform it's on, right? No, I don't. Huh. Alright. Somebody else wants to pitch their game. Anybody? Come on, go for it. You have 3 sentences. I want you to tell me 3 things. I want you to tell me what the name of your game is. Like, what is your game? I need you to tell me why you are making this game, and I need you to tell me why that game is interesting. Okay? I love that everybody's just passing on the microphone. There's a hand here. Andy, just throw it. No, don't throw it. Please don't throw it. Organization will kill me. By the way, thank you so much for pitching. I know that, like, that is a terrifying thing you just did.
I'm working on Quacko Rumble. It's a party game in which a player has to reach a certain area of the map, and the other one has to stop it by throwing it different things like barrels or boxes, depending on the level.
Okay. Good. He mentioned the name. Does anybody remember what the name is? All right, so how many remembered immediately what the name was? Okay, this is a reason why you say the name at the end as well. Okay? So, because then people will remember it. It's a party game. That sounds fun. What kind of game is it? No, you can't answer it. You know the answer. You throw stuff. So is it a 3D game? No? Oh, too bad. What platform was this? I still don't remember. That's rough. So, pitching, really, really hard. When you need to pitch, you need to be able to do it at any moment. And for all of you, by the way, not to make you feel bad, for all of you that raised your hand when I asked you, are you making a game, but then didn't raise their hand when I asked you to pitch, why the hell are you not pitching? Here's a chance to train your pitch. You can do it in front of an audience of nice people that all are not going to hate you when you're done. We all understand that this is a learning opportunity, so it's not a business opportunity. You had the opportunity right now to practice your pitch on somebody that has heard thousands of them, and you didn't do it. Next time, do it. Doesn't matter. Yes, you will feel bad when it doesn't go well. Yes, people are like, I will kind of be mean to you. Like, it's what I do. Like I said, what did I say? I said, honest feedback, right? Honesty. So that's what you get. That's what I need from you. That's what I need when I say honesty. I need you to be that honest so that people can make the best game they can. Okay? Thanks to both of you for pitching. Well done. Lesson 5. Take business seriously. I need you to take business as serious as you can. I need you to negotiate. I need you to invest. I need you to market. I need you to do market research. I need you to reach out to others. I need you to take your business seriously, because in the end, money is important. Yes, we do this for the love of it, but it's really hard to do something for the love of it if you can't do it for the love of it because your computer is broken and you can't afford a new one, or you can't pay rent, right? So take your business seriously. I negotiated for $1 once, and it sounds ridiculous, but it was $1 on top of $10,000, and it helped us go from $8,000 to $10,000. Negotiating always helps. When you see a contract, negotiate about it. If there's anything you don't like in a contract, negotiate about it. Talk about it. If you don't have an accountant, get an accountant, just in case. Don't have a lawyer and you don't understand something in a contract, ask somebody that does have a lawyer, or ask a lawyer. Okay? Take your business seriously. You have to do all of it seriously. Lesson 6, don't take business seriously. Whatever, right? Like, good business is really simple. You get more money in than is going out, you're doing a good job. All you need. There is good enough, right? I don't need you to do analysis of the market growth potential of your business. Like, I need you to make video games. That's what you do. You make video games. I need you to research as much as you need, but not more. I need you to do your business seriously so that you can run your company. You don't need to do more. You want to plan ahead, but I don't want you to plan details. The way you do this as an independent studio is you need every person on your team. If you don't need every person on your team, you have too many people. Get rid of them. But do everything as good as you can, and do it with as few people as you can. Now, I'm a fraud. So are you. We're all frauds. Like, everybody around us is better at everything we do than we are. And that's what everybody believes. Like, here, he's that bad that he leaves his phone on in a presentation. Like, just for a moment, can we appreciate that? Well done. Everybody feels like a fraud. Everybody feels like a fake. Everybody believes that everybody else is smarter than they are. And the reason for that is really simple. This is video games. There is no objective measurement. We always only look up. We never look down. We don't appreciate our own skills. We have there's an official term for it, imposter syndrome. We all believe we're an imposter. We all believe we're the fake, and that someday, somewhere, somebody is going to find out that we're terrible at our job and we don't know what we're doing. And I have good news. Nobody knows what they're doing. This entire industry is people freaking out continuously because they have no idea what's happening. Because this industry moves so fast and everybody is so good. But if we weren't good at our job, if we truly weren't good at our job, people would tell us. We wouldn't be here. We'd be sitting at home like smashing keys hoping that maybe one day I'll make, like, what, Super Mario or something? I don't know. The thing is, everybody feels like a fraud. So if you feel at any time like that, and I have a hard time believing anybody in this audience has never felt like that. Everybody feels that way. Even though we don't tell each other, because we're all scared that we're the only one that feels that way. Everybody feels that way. I would ask you to raise hands if you have felt that way, but the thing is, everybody has felt that way, even if we don't want to admit it. So, cool. So, the biggest currency we have is motivation. It's the biggest thing we have. Like, we can talk about money, we can talk about technology or knowledge, we can talk about motivation. The most important one is always motivation. Think of it this way. If we have three things and we need to lose one, okay? So, if you don't have the technology or the knowledge, but you have money and motivation, you can hire somebody that has the knowledge, right? If you don't have the money, but you have the technology and the knowledge and the motivation, you can be like us. You can just eat duck noodles for years and then fight with the other person over who gets to eat the chicken and the beef, right? But if you have all the money in the world and all the technology and the knowledge in the world, but you don't have motivation, nothing is going to happen. No video game is going to get made. So the most important thing is your motivation. Stay motivated. If you're not motivated for a while, stay disciplined. But nothing is worth burning out over. Nothing is worth getting demotivated over. So keep track of your mental health. Make sure that you're happy. Keep breaks. Don't crunch too much. Make sure that more than anything else, you protect you and how you feel, and that you're happy, and that you're energized. Don't sleep less because your game needs to be done. If you need to sleep less because your game needs to be done, punch your producer. Tell them that they fucked up and that they need to do a better job because I'm losing sleep over this video game. Staying motivated is so important. When Ridiculous Fishing got cloned, we had not taken care of ourselves for 2 years. And when it got cloned, it shut us down for a year. We lost a year. We almost lost the company because we were demotivated. And we hadn't taken care of ourselves, so we couldn't deal with it. Suddenly, everything came crashing down. And the only reason, literally the only reason, Vlambeer survived our second year is because a company in Canada asked us if they could make a mobile version of Super Crate Box. And we said yes. And they made the mobile version of Super Crate Box, and we got a part of that revenue because it was our game. And that money is the only money that kept Vlambeer in business at that point. And all of that was because we had not taken care of ourselves. So take care of yourselves, but Because more than anything else, it will cost you your company. It will cost you your studio. It will cost you your project. It will cost you your friends. It will cost you your loved ones. It will cost you your family. Watch out. Stay motivated. Stay mentally healthy. Stay in touch with everybody. Lesson 10. Ideas are really, really cheap. Everybody can have an idea in 30 seconds, in 10 seconds. If I tell you to have an idea right now, a game idea, in 10 seconds, you could all do it. Okay, somebody, give me an idea. Go.
A car that shoots arrows.
A car that shoots arrows.
Chicken fights.
Chicken fights. Somebody else?
Pterodactyl joust.
Pterodactyl joust. Somebody else in the back. Oh yeah, sure, go for it.
Unicorns versus Skynet.
Unicorns versus Skynet. I'll play that. Okay, now mechanics ideas. 10 seconds. Somebody, you. Somebody, you.
Tower defense
with?
Something else.
Yeah, an idea, not a genre.
Tower defense and platformers.
A tower defense platformer. I'd play that.
Instead of looting, like regular loot, I tag loot, and then I go back to base and craft it over there.
Okay, a game in which you have to craft loot before you can use it. Diablo. Not Diablo, really. Kind of Diablo. Anyway, so anybody here had ideas? Like, if you didn't have ideas, it's not that you don't have ideas, it's that you're too much of a perfectionist. Stop being too much of a perfectionist. Seriously, it's idea phase. You can shout whatever. If you sound like bird pooping on people in the street, that's a perfectly fine idea. If you say platformer in which gravity is upside down, 100% fine. During idea phase, have ideas. Have bad ideas. Have the worst ideas. And you know why? Because failure is good. The best way to learn in our industry is to mess up and do it wrong. You know why? Because when you do something right, all that you've learned is that at that point in time, that specific thing you were doing worked. That's all you learn. You learn nothing else. You can't even redo it because times have changed. Context has changed. If I make Super Crate Box today, nobody will give a shit. That game kickstarted our career in 2010. If I did it today, nothing would happen. So, fail. Because when you fail, you learn a lot more. You learn what doesn't work. You learn why it doesn't work. You can analyze why it doesn't work. Well, for what works, that's too late. Somebody already did it. This is useless now. So focus on your failures. Focus on creating environments in which you can fail. Focus on creating an environment where people can have dumb ideas and talk about them. Focus on an environment in which you can try lots of prototypes before you commit to a project. Focus on being able to fail. If you are in an environment where you can fail, that's going to be the most useful, the most educational environment you can be in. If you're in an environment where literally everything will have to go well, it won't. It never does. There was a producer once in the games industry that my friends talk about with a lot of laughter. They used to work at a really big AAA studio. And on the first day of his job, he came into the studio and he said, "From now on, I want only home runs." I don't know if you've ever watched baseball, but if a coach tells their team, "From now on, I want only home runs," they just laugh at him. Because that's a dumb idea. That's not how the industry works. That's not how the game works. You can't 100% home runs. You will mess up. Make sure you're in an environment where that is okay. Make sure that you're in a place where that is okay. That's the best place you can be in, is a place where you can fail. Now, lesson 12 is the industry is people. And it's a small industry. So take care. Okay? Good news travels really fast. Bad news travels really fast. So you want to support each other. You want to be helpful. You want to be kind. Your community is everything. Right? Because on our own, most of us are small studios. We don't have a huge impact on the world. We're just a bunch of people making video games. But the community is so much more. And if you can get together, if you can help each other out, if you can create an environment in which you learn from each other, in which you help each other, in which you help each other succeed, everybody in the community gets better. And when everybody in the community gets better, you can reach for great things. You can do what people say is impossible. You can create an environment wherein everybody can succeed, or at least everybody can have a positive experience. And the industry is all sorts of people. Don't forget that. Any type of person, no matter their race, or their sex, or their gender, or their sexual orientation, whatever, is a part of this industry. The only thing you need to be part of this industry is make games. You don't need to be good at it. You just need to start making games, and you're a part of this industry. If you come across somebody that makes terrible, terrible games, give them honest feedback, but then tell them that you are thankful that they are part of this industry. Tell them that you are happy that they found something that they love, and help them. Don't just give the honest feedback. Give the honest feedback in a way that helps them become a better game developer. Give back to everybody that's part of this medium, because everybody is so, so valuable. Everybody is so important to this medium. Make sure that everybody always feels welcome. Always. No matter who they are, or where they're from, or what they look like, or whatever, really. Make sure they feel welcome. Lesson 13. Everything is a remix. I don't mean everything is a remix the way most people interpret it. Most people interpret it as everything is a mix of two already existing ideas. People very often say there are no new ideas. Those people have no fucking idea what they're talking about. Super Crate Box looks like Super Mario, right? And it's a game in which you collect crates, and then when you collect a crate, you get a random new weapon. That was in 2010. Nobody had ever made that game before. Sure, it looks like other games, but it's not other games. It's something new. Nobody had ever made a game in which you shoot fish with machine guns. In 2013, nobody had made that game. We went for 2,000 years, more than 2,000 years of human civilization, and nobody ever made a game where you fling fish up into the air and then shoot them with machine guns. I couldn't believe it either, but it's true. What everything is a remix means has nothing to do with mixing ideas. What everything is a remix means is that in your head is an infinite amount of information. There's infinite amounts of experiences, things you've seen, things you've done. What creativity is nothing else than your brain rearranging that stuff into weird things. So you want to know what ridiculous fishing, how we came to that idea? We were watching a documentary about tuna fishing. It was just a boat, and there were a bunch of like dudes in like jackets pulling fish up onto the boat. And one shot was this beautiful slow motion shot of somebody like pulling a boat, a fish, sorry, not a boat, that would be cool, pulling a fish up into the air, and it was slow motion, and the fish flew in front of the sun, and the sun was setting, and it was water dripping everywhere. And me and JW were watching that, and we had just been talking about Duck Hunt. It's a game in which you shoot an orange fake pistol at a TV. And I went, what if we combine that? And that's how Ridiculous Fishing started. Super Crate Box started because we really like a lot of games, but we hate that in a lot of games there's an optimal state. There's an optimal weapon, and when you fire that weapon, you're fine. You can just stand there as long as you have ammo. So we wanted to make a game in which you have to move. That's how Super Crate Box started. When we did Nuclear Throne, we were inspired by lots of bad 70s sci-fi. Just like bad sci-fi books. We read a lot of sci-fi books, and we just wanted to make a game about that. We also wanted to make a game that was unpredictable for us, so it turned into a roguelike. So there are all these different influences continuously moving around in your head. And everything is a remix. Everything is a remix of all those ideas. So you know how you can get better at making games? Don't make games. Go out there. Do weird shit. Go do the thing you never do. If you never go outside to walk, go outside to walk. If you never go skydiving, go skydiving. You don't travel, go travel. You've never been outside of like your hometown. I don't know if you're born here and you're still here. Like you've never gone outside, go outside. Don't read books? Read a book. Don't watch movies? Watch movies. Don't like pop music? I spent my last weekend listening to One Direction. Fucking hate One Direction. But I wanted to know what it was about. I wanted to know why people listened to that. So I listened to that because after listening to One Direction, they had one song that I kind of liked. And that tune has been stuck in my head for a week now. And I hummed that part of that song to my musician on Nuclear Throne. And he said it sounded kind of cool. So maybe that's going to be in a Nuclear Throne song now. Who knows? Every piece of knowledge you can get is useful. Every experience you can get is useful. Everything you do is useful. So do everything. Do the things you don't like. You hate playing certain type of games? Play those types of games. I hate racing games. Bought every racing game for a year just to play them to see what's interesting. Lesson 14. Your game can talk to you. Okay? We very often like to... Oh, God. Time's running out. We very often like to think that we create the game. Right? It's our game. Not true. Game starts from us. We plant a seed in the ground. Then a tree starts growing. Right? Then the tree grows, and we want the tree to grow there, but sometimes the tree just kind of goes there. I don't know why. Maybe there was a storm. Maybe, I don't know, the tree is kind of tired or something. I don't know. The tree starts going that way. Now, if you take a tree and you try to bend it back up, what happens? It breaks. Because that's not how trees grow. Trees grow. If you want to move it back, you're going to have to carefully do that and then make it go back up. The problem is, it won't be the straight tree that you imagined. You imagined a beautiful, beautiful straight tree. It'll be a tree with a really weird, like, bend in it. That'll look kind of weird. It's not the game you wanted to make. Could be the game you end up making. What you could do instead is just accept that this tree is now growing that way. And take care of the game as it's growing that way. The same thing happens to game ideas. We very often have a very, very strict idea of what a game should be. Sometimes that game is just a really bad game. Sometimes the game doesn't want to be that game. That sounds really weird and kind of like ephemeral or like spooky or like where I'm suddenly got all spiritual about this. The honest reality is this is just how the creative process works. We are not always in control. The creative process is allowing the creative work to be in control sometimes too. Okay? If you ever want to do a fun challenge, at the end of the year, November, there's a writing challenge. It's called NaNoWriMo, National Novel Writing Month. The goal in that month is to write 50,000 words in 1 month. A story of 50,000 words. That is 1,667 words a day, every day, almost 2,000 words. The trick to win that is A, not be a perfectionist, and B, just write. Don't have too much of a plan, just go and see what happens. And at some point, you will find that you are not writing your characters, but your characters write themselves. That you're not trying to steer what they do, but they just do what they should. That's the creative process. It's getting to the point where the creative work speaks as much as you do. So learn to listen to your game. Don't rely on patterns. There's a lot of patterns, there's a lot of conventions, a lot of rules. Those are not necessarily useful. If everybody is making game A, don't make game A. Because by the time somebody picks up on the idea that game A is a very good idea, they all started working on game A. So if you also start working on game A, you're too late. As soon as any of you see a trend in the industry, check if anybody else has seen it. If nobody has seen it, you're probably just in time, because a lot of people have seen it. If somebody has seen it, if somebody has mentioned it, you're already too late. If you ever hear a tip from somebody in a talk at GDC or at Gamescom, that tip is hopelessly outdated. Anybody gives you any specific advice on how to deal with the press, that information is 3 years old. You know why? Because first, we try something, right? We try a new idea, then we see whether it works. So trying a new idea takes a few months, then seeing whether it works takes a few months, then the game has to come out and prove that it worked, that takes a few months. Then we have to look back at it and figure out that that is the thing that worked. And then we have to write a talk about it, submit that talk, and then when the talk is submitted, wait until the event actually happens. That's about a year and a half between us figuring out that it works and us giving the talk. In the meanwhile, everybody has kind of seen that it works, everybody has tried it, and now it's the old thing. Okay? So when anybody gives you a very specific tip, that tip is usually outdated. If they give it to you in person, that's fine. But if they give it to you through a talk, if you read about it on a website, if you hear about it in a school book, it's old. Okay? Same thing with programming tips in school books or, you know, anything really. It's like the games industry moves so fast, if you can find it in anything that is formal, it's outdated. Don't rely on that. Now, do rely on other conventions. There's a reason why the left analog stick is movement. And the right analog stick is looking around. Sure, you could flip that around. That just makes your game really fucking confusing. It doesn't do anything. So don't break conventions just for the sake of breaking conventions, unless the point of your game is breaking conventions. Keep to the good conventions. Figure out which are patterns or trends. Don't rely too much on those. So the world is out there. Congratulations, you're here. You did a good job. If any other developers you know are not here for any reason, but they couldn't afford it, or there is a emergency, or there are social reasons, they fucked up. The best way to learn is literally go to where other game developers are. Talk to them. You did well. Keep doing that. If there's an event nearby, do it. If you can afford going there, do it. If it's 3 hours away, do it. If it's 6 hours away, do it. If you have to fly for it, do it. I spend all of my days on airplanes. Most of my days on airplanes, really. I learn amazing amounts of information. I learned today, I learned about how the industry here is doing. That's super cool information. Hope that for somebody else it will be useful when they ask about it. But the world is out there. Go to every event that you can go to. Talk to every game developer that you can find. You can't make the game in your head. I'm sure we all have a great game idea. We just talked about great game ideas. What was it? Skynet versus unicorns? That's great. Whatever idea is in your head, you can't make that. Does not work. Will never work. The game idea in our head is a terrible fucking game idea. You know why? Because it's in our head. Our head does not work like a computer. Our head is really good at filling in the blanks. Our head is really good at imagining things that aren't there. Our head is really good at making something work. If I tell you a game in which you... It's an RPG on the clouds, and you're trying to get to a sky castle with a dragon. You can all fill that in. You can fill in 100 details about how it works. That's not how a computer works. If I tell a computer that, I get nothing. The computer just goes, I don't know what the hell you're talking about. You get a syntax error or whatever error, it breaks. My computer formats itself, and it's done. Right? So, that doesn't work. If you want to make a game, you have to make a game for a computer. Don't forget that. A game in your head is not a game on a computer, and you're never going to be able to translate something from your brain to your computer. You can get close, you can try to get close, but it'll never work. Accept that. It'll never be the game you have in your head. It will always be the game that it is on the computer. Lesson 18. Don't define things for other people. Don't try to define what games are. Don't try to define what indie is. Don't try to define what art is. Don't try to define what a good engine is. Don't try to define what a bad engine is. Don't define things for others. My games are made in Game Maker. Most people consider Game Maker an awfully shit game development tool. I do not give a shit. Because I make games in it, and the games I make, I think, are good games. And a lot of people enjoy my games, and they think they're good games. They don't care what engine it's made in. You want to use Unity, go and use Unity. You hate Unity, cool, keep it to yourself. Why the hell would you tell people Unity is a bad game-making thing? You see how much it's, you know how much I see that? Go on any game development forum and just look at how many people are saying, this is not a game, or this is not art, or Unity is a bad engine. Why would you waste your time on that? Go and make your games. If you ever catch yourself trying to define something for others, punch yourself, then get back to work. Don't even try to define good game or bad game. Like, you can't do that. Like, a game could be good for most people and bad for other people. Lesson 19. Decide, don't accept. This is the most valuable lesson I've ever had. You can decide so many things. But so many people are okay with just accepting things because that's how they are. Try to make as many things in your life as possible a choice. Something that you've stopped, looked at, thought about, then made a decision. Okay? There are a lot of game development teams that I come across that started because during school they did a game jam with four people at a game development university or something. Did a game jam with 4 to 6 people. Then they graduated and they continued with those 6 people. And they just did that because it was 6 people. And then their company fails because 6 people is way too much to sustain if you're just starting out. And the company folds and they all go somewhere else. Well, if they had just looked at the situation and been like, okay, listen, we're going to start a company. We kind of need 4 people. We can't sustain 6. You can offer the other 2 a good deal that they'll be happy with, and you can sustain your company. Done. So many things in life are decisions. In fact, our job is making decisions. If you are an entrepreneur, if you lead the company, your life's going to be full of really hard decisions. It's going to be full of really shitty decisions. It's going to be full of deciding, which person am I going to get rid of? Which game am I not going to make? Am I going to cancel this game? Am I going to tell them that, sorry, I know you want to make a premium game, but we're going to have to make a freemium game? Life's going to be full of those decisions. If you're a designer, similarly, your life's going to be full of decisions. If you're an artist, your life's full of decisions. Audio design is full of decisions. Make sure you're making decisions. Don't just do a thing because that thing. Again, ask yourself why. So lesson 20, meet your heroes. Dare to ask them things. If you have somebody in the games industry that you really look up to, send them an email. Okay, do it today. Just after this talk, go send somebody that you really appreciate an email and ask them that question that you've always wanted to ask them. They might not immediately respond, they might not respond, but teach yourself to do that. If you come across somebody that's inspiring to you, if you come across somebody that has a lot of experience in the industry, if you come across somebody that you would go and sit in a fucking room to listen to for an hour, ask them the questions that you want to ask. Ask me the questions that you want to ask. No, but seriously, ask me questions. The One Direction song was it was one of their new ones from their new album. What's it called? It's
sing it.
No, so it was the I'm terrible at singing. It was the one song where they got really where all the fans completely lost their mind over Harry Styles singing it at a live show. And that's all I remember. But it was a pretty good song. No, I can't sing it. I can find it on my phone. But I forgot everything about it except for that I liked it. Another question.
How long are you going to stay here?
I think until tomorrow evening, but it might be the next day evening. I don't know. I forgot to look at my schedule because I'm flying all the time. No, but seriously, ask me questions. Only one person asks questions? No, you have questions?
How would you, starting up from scratch, how do you go and try to convince somebody, you know, to have some sort of loan going on or some sort of investment to your company in order to, you know, well, begin cranking out games and whatnot?
So, number one is you need to already be making games. You can't start without a game. If you don't have anything, nobody's going to give you money. Number two is you need to have your pitch down. So that thing we did with the pitching round, 3 rules. You get nothing more. 3 sentences. After 3 sentences, I stop giving a shit. Everybody stops giving a shit. And the final one is have a good business case. Take your business serious. So if you have money, if you need money, you're playing the money game, not the game development game. If you're playing the money game, you need to be able to tell somebody that they're going to get their money back. You need to be able to convince them that you are trustworthy enough, that you are capable enough to make a thing and make money. So you need a game, you need a business case. If you can get people those two things, it's possible to get money. The other thing is, there's a really weird thing with getting money. Where getting money between $0 and like $100,000 is pretty easy. I'm not gonna say it's easy, but it's easier. Then from like $100,000 to like $500,000, it gets really, really hard for some reason. Then from $500,000 and up, it's easier again. And the reason for that is really simple. There are small funds that focus on small investments. And they focus on those investments under 100,000. Then there's big funds and publishers, stuff like that. They focus on the big stuff. So they focus on like $500,000 and up. If you need like the 100,000 to 500,000, you need to either skill up or skill down. But there's nobody in that center part. You need to, that's what I mean with you have to think about business. You have to think about business in a business way. Why would somebody invest? What kind of group would I target for investments? And what do I get out of this and what can I offer them back? Okay? Yeah?
You told us that you have the opportunity to see our industry, our game industry.
Yeah.
What's your opinion about the Argentinian game industry and from South America, you had the opportunity to look for it.
Yeah. So what do I think of the industry here? I mean, I see an industry that is in growth. But I also see an industry that is in large part dependent on external work. So a lot of people here seem to be in some way dependent on funding from outside of the country, are an outsourcing company or work for hire company. There's nothing wrong with that, but it's also hard to sustain. Because as the industry grows, the level of expertise is going to go up, and as the level of expertise is going to go up, the salaries are going to go up as well. that's just kind of the way it works. If you get better, you'll have opportunity to get better jobs, so you're going to have to pay more to get those people here. So you might run into two situations if the situation stays exactly as it is. One is brain drain, where people that are really good move elsewhere to get a better salary. Or two is the people that now depend on here for outsourcing move their business elsewhere because it's cheaper. So there's going to have to be a transition at some point where people start making their own games, their own products, their own IPs, and then build the industry on that. But besides that, I see a very strong community. I see events that are huge that bring people in from all over the place. It doesn't matter whether I'm in Argentina or Brazil or any of the other countries. I always see people from all over the continent going there. So I see really strong community. I see very huge potential. I've seen some really interesting games just today in my meetings, just amazing things. And I also see the early stages of that transition from being a more of a service economy as a country, where a lot of the games industry is focused on being a service to other countries, to being an economy of its own. And that's really exciting to me.
I'm curious about what you think the visibility that indies are getting on Steam is less and less, because many developers are going out there with their games, and this is not so sustainable for a long time, I think. And first question is, where do you see yourself in 5 years with this rhythm of a lot of concurrency?
Yeah.
And Vlambeer is a very well-known studio, but there are a lot of other many studios that are not so well-known, and will have things will be harder for them.
Yeah. So first thing I wanted to say, if you ever have to sneak into a room like that, close the door quickly. It's a very odd thing, but like trying to close it very carefully just makes it make more noise. So just slam it. It's fine. So yeah, Steam is in a very weird spot. But actually, indie games is in a really weird spot. Actually, the entire games industry is in a really weird spot. Like, all of the games industry is doing poorly. AAA is doing poorly because the budgets went up too much and the prices didn't go up accordingly. Indie is in a weird spot because there are so many of us that it's hard to get noticed. The middle area is kind of in a good spot. Mobile is in a terrible spot because literally nobody knows what the hell is happening there anymore. So everything is in a bad spot. You can see it. Like, all the mobile companies are starting to make PC games because they think it's better at PC. But it's not, because all the PC companies are starting to do console games, because they can't get noticed on PC, so they're moving to console. All the console games are suddenly starting to make mobile apps as well, because it's cheaper and it makes more money. And like, everybody's like, let's move to the other thing, and everybody is like, no, this is terrible. So the games industry is in a really weird spot. The thing that I think is important to know is that it's always been bad. The games industry has always been bad. And every time there is an opportunity, and that opportunity is always somewhere else. But if you're looking up from starting, you see those opportunities because they're the things that are accessible to you. So now I saw a lot of people jump on VR, and VR might or might not work out, right? But if it does work out and you're that one game that does VR interesting, suddenly you've got opportunity. As the middle area of the games industry starts to like boot back up, Capybara, Clyde Games, our type of games, there's going to be room just underneath that. If you can hit a production level that is similar to Ridiculous Fishing or higher, you can take that space. The thing is, you need to find those opportunities, and those opportunities change all the time. And the problem is, you need to see them a year in advance. So the honest reality is, for everybody in this room, if you're starting out now, it's part going to be, are you able to see those trends coming and be a coin flip? That's the way business has always been, that's the way business is always going to be, is you can never predict what will work out. I can tell you the entire story of why Vlambeer worked, and I would just be talking shit. Because I don't know. I'm not 100% sure. I have my suspicions, but I think we were just in the right place at the right time with the right game. Like, in 2010, everybody was suddenly focusing on like mechanics first games. Super Great Box is a mechanics first game. That's how we got noticed. So, on the other end, like, the thing that you need to do is you just need to stand out. You know, just need to make something that really connects with people. But again, the way you do that is by making something that is genuine, something that is you, and something that is you in the best way it can be. And that works. Like, a game that is special works, like a Gone Home works. Does that mean that a shooting game doesn't work? No, it doesn't. Rocket League worked as well, right? So anything can work as long as it's 100% that. No compromises. Make the game that you want to make. Make the game that game wants to be. If you make one compromise, it's over. I'll take one more. Do I have time for one more?
You have plenty of time, actually.
I have plenty of time. Awesome. My timer says that I've been going for like 4 hours at this point.
Maybe your time's wrong. You're good.
Can you share with us a number of your favorite games and favorite game designers?
Oh, yeah. Favorite game. So the first game I ever bought was Metal Gear Solid. So I'm really excited to play Metal Gear Solid 5. Turns out I'm traveling for the next month, so I won't be home for a while. I actually really like Destiny right now, which is very surprising to a lot of people, but I love the gun feel in that game. Like, jumping is great, and double jumping is awesome. Cave Story is one of my favorites. I love Cave Story. It's just amazing to me that somebody could sit down and make a game for 5 years, and that is it. I really love Fly Wrench, which was just re-released on Steam, which I would absolutely recommend. There's a game called Snakebird that came out the other day. I fucking hate that game, but I love it so much. It's a puzzle game where, like, level one, you look at it and you go like, oh, this is cute. Level two, you go like, huh, that's interesting. And level three, you just flip your table in rage because you can't fucking solve it for 20 minutes. You're like, this is level three. How can this be that hard? And then you realize the map has 53 levels and you just start crying and shut down the game. But it's really good. I can really recommend it. And I'm currently enjoying a game called Rising Thunder a lot. It's a fighting game. It's a free-to-play fighting game on PC. Made by Seth Killian, who's a fighting game expert. And he made a fighting game where you don't have to learn combos. So if you want to do the most powerful attack on a character, you just hit one button. And then there's a cooldown for that attack. And it's really clever because it allows everybody to be a pro fighting game player. Or at least to get to the point where you're not thinking about how to quarter circle backwards, half circle forward, be a strong kick, whatever, right? You just go to the point where you go, I think you're going to do that attack, so I'm going to do this. And that, for me, is the interesting part of fighting games. So I really like that game. There used to be a really old Game Boy Color game called Monkey Puncher, which was a game about training monkeys to punch for boxing contests. And it was really weird, but I really liked it because it was weird. And there was an old Super Nintendo game called Act Racer, which was a game in which you played like a god, and you had to build cities, and then every now and then something would attack the cities, and it would turn into a 2D platformer game where you had to protect the cities that you built. And then this really cool zoom-in effect when you went from building the city to fighting, and it would zoom all the way to the ground. And I love that. Oh, and I'm a huge StarCraft fan. I love video games. I play way too many video games. Sorry, you asked for my favorite games, not for a history of video games. Super Mario Bros. He has the microphone, but after that.
Why do you make games? What do you want to bring to the world if you want to bring something more than just fun time?
Good question, right? Starts with why, usually a good question. Let me sip my water. So, I believe games are special. So I believe that when you read a book, you know, and you ask somebody, what did you read? I read Lord of the Rings, right? So what is Lord of the Rings about? Lord of the Rings is about Frodo, who has to go to Mount Doom and throw a ring into the fire. There's a lot more story, but that's basically what it comes down to. Story about good and evil and all that. If you watch a movie, I watched Die Hard the other day. Die Hard is about John McClane kicking a terrorist off a roof. Really, it's about a lot more, but that's basically a short summary. And you play a video game, and you play Super Mario Bros., and you ask people what they're doing, they say, oh, I'm jumping over this hole. Or I'm saving the world. Or I'm doing this. And they don't talk about other characters. They don't talk about John McClane. They don't talk about Frodo. They talk about me. They talk about I. They talk in first person. I think that's really special. Here we have a medium where, you know how a movie can make you feel sad? Or a book can make you feel anxious? You know what a game can make you feel? Regret. You know how awesome that is? We can make people feel regret. We can make people feel proud. No book can make you feel proud. No movie can make you feel proud. We can make you feel proud. We can let you do something that make you think that you are the best at this shit. Even though you probably suck, to be honest. Like, right? You can make a game in which solving the first level will make you feel clever. Snakebird, I have never felt prouder at Snakebird than beating level 5. And I know that people have beaten the entire game, but I was proud. You can feel responsible. You can play a game and feel responsible for what happens to the characters. That's amazing. Like, a video game to me is like a little tiny conversation that I get to have with somebody every millisecond, where what they see goes into their brain, and then they think about it, and then they press a button. And that's like a tiny little conversation. Now, I was talking about this before at lunch, but to me, the most special moments in art, in media, are the moments where you can see the person that made it behind it, right? So Nuclear Throne, in my latest game, there's the final boss fight. And as you go to the final boss fight, there's this long, long room all the way into the distance. And in that room is a carpet. And the carpet is a long red carpet and it goes all the way to the final boss. And the final boss is this huge throne. And on the throne is a tiny little skeleton that's been sitting there for ages. What you need to do is you need to shoot the skeleton. Right, so you walk down the carpet and you shoot the skeleton, and then the room starts shaking, right? And this is after like 70 hours of gameplay. People have played the game for 70 hours by the time they get good enough to do this. And then the fight starts, and the first thing that happens is the throne turns into this giant robot spider that shoots a laser beam exactly over the carpet. Nowhere else, exactly over the carpet, exactly where every player voluntarily stands. We don't tell you to stand on the carpet. People stand on the carpet because the carpet looks like you have to stand on it. We shoot the laser. If you're in front of the laser, you die. You start back at the first level of the game.
Spoilers!
And that's, you know what that is? That is us saying, fuck you. That is all it is. It is us telling the player, you thought you beat this game? Uh-uh. This is our game, and you're dead. Start over. And I love those moments. Those moments are the moments where I get to wink. Get to wink at the player, like, hey, you thought we had a deal? We don't have a deal. Start over. Go back. That, to me, is special about games. Those moments are special to me about games. We get to have those little conversations. We get to do the little winks. We get to tell our player to fuck off. We get to tell our player, well done. We get to, like, hug our players through the game and be like, 3 stars! Awesome! Fireworks! Like, we have all this space, all this medium to play with, to do interesting things with, to teach people, to let people play and like mess around, to make them feel smart or like dumb or clever or sad. We can do all of the things movies can, but more. That's exciting. That's really fucking exciting to me, and I'm super happy that I can be part of this industry right now.
He's got the mic.
Oh, no, she was first.
She was first?
So my question to you is, you mentioned that your studio is two people, you and your partner, there's a lot of identity in that statement. At the same time, you mentioned that you collaborate with a sound designer and there with other people. So I would love to hear more about how you work to have these two people studio, but at the same time it's more than that.
Yeah.
So how does that work for you?
That's a really good question. I like that question a lot. So here's the thing. So the question is, how does the strong identity of Vlambeer being a two-man studio work with the fact that sometimes a lot more people work for us? So we work exclusively with freelancers. We think that's a very healthy way of working for us. It means that the studio can stay small and our burn rate can stay low. If we ever get in trouble, we can tell the freelancers that the job is over and then it's done. And we almost exclusively work with revenue share. So the people that work for us get paid based on profits. It means that we basically have zero costs except for my own salary, my colleague's salary in the office, which our burn rate is effectively zero. For a studio that whose games do as well as Vlambeer's, our current burn rate is less than 7,000 euros a month, which is absolutely nothing for a game studio of our allure status, whatever. So we usually work with people that we've met through game jams or people that we've met in real life. If we like their work, we'll ask them. if they want to collaborate. One of our current collaborators is an artist that sent us fan art, and we thought the fan art was so good that we asked him to do a new drawing for us in commission. Then when we liked that, we brought him aboard as a freelancer. It turned out he was 17, so he was not legally allowed to work for us. And then when he turned 18, we hired him. So that was cool. But the most interesting part about your statement is that you pinpointed the fact that there's a lot of identity to the fact that Vlambeer is a two-man studio, and that is true. It actually sounds really nice to be a two-person studio, so we keep telling that story. We keep telling people that we're a two-man studio, not just because it's true, but also because it sounds really good. And that's something you need to realize. Like, a lot of things sound really good. We're a two-man studio from the Netherlands, sounds really nice, and there's a lot of identity there. So I hope that answers the first part of your question, but I want to talk a bit about that identity thing because I think it's really important. So I mentioned at the start of the talk that Vlambeer is 5 years old, right? I normally never really mention that, and there's a reason I don't really mention that, and the reason I don't mention that is because part of Vlambeer, part of the brand of Vlambeer for us, is that Vlambeer has to have existed forever. Like, we don't want Vlambeer to be a thing with a start and an end. We want Vlambeer to be this thing that people think about as indie games. They think about indie games, I want people to think about Vlambeer. It's a lot harder to think about Vlambeer when you think about Vlambeer as such an integral part of indie games if you know that we had a starting point. So I don't mention our starting year. In fact, if you go to our website, every time you visit our website, it generates a new random founding year. So you can go to our website and see that Vlambeer was founded in 1921. And we've had press questions about that, where people ask us, so the website says you were founded in 1921, can you talk about that? And then I would explain to the journalist that our grandparents started a woodworking company and then decided to make board games. And it's all bullshit. And one website actually printed that, and we had to email them, like, listen, no, we were joking. We thought you understood it was a joke. And they had to remove that part. It's really funny. But there's a lot of things to Vlambeer's identity that are important to us. So I want Vlambeer to be forever, basically. That doesn't mean the company is going to be forever. I don't think the company is going to be. If somebody asks me where I'm going to be in 5 years, I don't know if Vlambeer still exists in 5 years. Like, I'm having fun right now, but if I stop having fun, if it stops being interesting, if we stop having a value to the world, I'm going to go do something else, just like my colleague. But I want it to feel like forever. I don't want Vlambeer to be a thing that people think of as having a start or an end. I want people to think Vlambeer is helpful. We spend a lot of time on giving more than we take. And we spend a lot of time making sure that people know where to find the things that we make. Just because to the brand, I think it's really important that people understand that we're trying to help. We're not trying to take away from the industry. We're trying to give to the industry. And if the industry is better, even if it's just a tiny bit, if the industry is this much better because of Vlambeer, I'm happy, right? Because that is ultimately part of what I'm trying to do. And the final thing, I want people to think of Vlambeer as like a studio that's kind of silly. Like, I don't want people to think serious things when they think Vlambeer. I want people to think silly things. So we will do stupid shit all year round. We will release our game at the worst time of the year. Release our game live on a show floor. I've once released a game literally from on the floor at GDC with a journalist sitting next to me asking me what I was doing. And I was sitting on the floor, like in a corner right there with a laptop, just being like, oh, I'm launching a video game. He's like, what? I'm like, I'm launching a video game. He's like, can I interview you? I'm like, sure. Because that is Vlambeer. Vlambeer to me is also a bit spontaneous, a bit silly, a bit weird, a bit screen shake. Like, that's what Vlambeer has to be to me. But like, figure out who you are. Like, figure out what your studio is, what it needs to mean, and then when you figure that out, be that. Be the most of that you can be. Make sure that your studio is you. Don't try to make it into something else. Don't pretend to be something. You know one thing that really pisses off the press? Writing a really formal email. You know why? Because they're people. They're not a job interview. They're people that write about games, that love games. They want you to communicate how much you love your game. If you want to write a really formal email, go deal with the tax agencies or something. Ask them how their day is. Like, then write a really formal email. If you want to work with the Games Press, don't write a formal email. Just be you. Just always be you. Focus on being you. That's okay. Yeah, sure. Next question. 5 minutes?
Yeah.
5 minutes. Okay.
What happened with GameDev.World?
So GameDev.World is still under development. So the thing that happened is GameDev.World is, for those who don't know it, it's a website in which I'm going to collect all sorts of information about game development. I'm going to translate it into the five major languages of the world that aren't currently covered, including Spanish, Portuguese, Russian, Arabic, and Chinese. And that's all going to be available for free. Like, it's a project I'm doing because I feel the language barrier is kind of an asshole. I don't want to break it. So GameDev.World is something that I announced in January of this year. We were hoping to launch it by April or June, but it turns out that finding the correct information and then translating it costs a lot of time. So we've been moving to more of an advisory board system. It's been taking a lot of time, and in the meanwhile, another project that I'm working on, Do Distribute, has gotten a lot bigger. So I've been maintaining that. But GameDev.World is under development, and it's actually under development. It's just taking a lot more. I hope to have a bit more news by like November, December, and then hopefully somewhere in the first half of the next year I can launch it fully, and then we can go from there. It's just, it turns out that there is a lot of responsibility in curating the best information of the industry and trying to make sure that none of that information is harmful to other people. Like, telling people that education and creativity, that education in creative works is not that important, for example, is terrible advice for somebody in South Africa. Because if in South Africa you don't have an education and you live in Johannesburg, you're basically like a drugs dealer. And things just go wrong. So if you give that advice to somebody there, you just fuck over their life. And I didn't quite realize that when I started on this project, but there's a lot of responsibility that I want to make sure that we get it right. Like, I want to make sure that GameDev.World is a positive thing. So it's, sorry, it's taking a bit more time.
You have one more.
Make it a really weird one.
Why the $1?
Ha!
Why the $1?
Okay. So, a long, long time ago, I can still remember, we made a game called Radical Fishing. It was our very first game. Nobody had ever heard of us. And me and JW, we were trying to make Crates from Hell into Super Crate Box. Remember, that was the start of our story. And we were eating noodles, but we didn't have money for noodles because we were high school dropouts. We had no money. All the money that I had was coming from a little side job. I was a computer salesman in a retail store. And pretty much all of the money went to my rent, because I didn't live with my parents anymore at that point. I had a big fight with my dad. My dad is super supportive, but he's very Egyptian, so you can be three jobs. You can be a doctor, or an engineer, or a lawyer, and if you're not one of those three things, you're kind of a failure. And I told him I was going to make video games. So I wasn't too happy about that. So to not have to deal with that, I moved out, and I had my own place. So all of my money went to that rent. Don't get me wrong, my dad's an amazing dude, but that was just something. There was a part of our life where we didn't work really well. So we didn't have any. We had zero, just zero money whatsoever. And we decided to make Super Crate Box into a thing. We needed three extra people. We needed to be able to pay them for about 6 months, and we needed to pay for ourselves, for our own lives, and we were students, so we basically needed nothing. We just needed to eat noodles, right? And Coca-Cola. Drink Coca-Cola, you don't eat Coca-Cola. So we had calculated that we needed $6,000. So we made Radical Fishing, and it was a flash game, and we were trying to sell it to a website. So we emailed every website that we could find, and we got like 8 offers that were all $4,000. So we emailed them back and we said, listen, we have a lot of offers for $4,000, but we really need an offer for $6,000. We're not going to sell under $6,000. And then we only had 3 left. Then we went like, okay, we have 3. So what if we just tell one of them that we have $8,000? And then, you know, it's a bluff, but maybe they'll go to $8,000. So we told them, like, listen, sorry, we have an offer for $8,000. We really like your offer, but if you're not going to match $8,000, we're not going to talk about this. And they went like, okay, $8,000. So then we went to the dude that still said $6,000, and we said, listen, we have an offer for $8,000. If you want to offer 8,000, that's a deal. So one of them said yes, and the other one didn't. So we lost the other one. Then we had two left. So we did it again. So we said, okay, listen, we have an offer for 10,000. Would you like to do 10,000? And one of them kind of was like maybe, and the other one was like no. So we started talking with the one that said maybe, and we said, listen, we have an offer for 10,000, which was bullshit. That's not the point. We were negotiating. We said, we have an offer for 10,000, but we don't really like that company. So if you just offer more than 10,000, doesn't matter how much, anything over 10,000, and we'll sign it. So they emailed back 10,001. And we signed it. So we bluffed $4,001 onto our price, $6,001, well, $4,001 onto our price. And that's the story of the $1. So, as a final little thing, make a photo of this website. It's a free website full of tools, free tools, things, links, interesting talks, things I think that are important if you don't have this. This is a good link to have. I try to keep it somewhat up to date. That was that. You can follow us here on Twitter. If you're on Twitter, send me a hi or a hello or anything, something nice. And thank you so much.